listen to the complete video on YouTube. The series is The Black Man Must Wake Up, and it is video number 3. He argues with passionate certainty that there is a fatal contradiction when black people are fed a history of themselves based on materials written, controlled, and approved by white folks. His arguments raise the powerful question, would whites or any other group agree to embrace a history of themselves created and controlled by black people? So who are we to believe? Who should we believe? Who must we believe? We have to believe our own people. They are victims too, and they speak on our behalf, those who do. We should not believe those who enslaved us for over 2,000 years or those who are helping them to sell us this lie. It is said that if someone doesn't treat you right, they will not teach you right either. Now, the question some of our people have is, how could a few criminals overtake the whole continent, capture millions of Africans, and take them away for hundreds of years? It's a good question. They ask about our great empires, our dynasties, our kingdoms and armies. To understand the answer, we have to ask, what defense do birds have against hunters with shotguns when their natural ability to fly is used against them as they move across the open sky? What defense do fishes in the ocean have against fishermen using nets over a mile wide? Sure, the fish can swim, but here again, the very nature of their being has caused them to be in an open environment that is used against them. Abyssinians are very kind and trusting. We were not prepared for this. We had no weapons to speak of. We are a peaceful people by nature, and that peace was used against us by wicked outsiders who had machine guns, who brought their lifestyle of war, destruction, and immorality to our continent. Through the books they gave us, we were led to believe that Columbus and others were just greedy individuals seeking self-riches. What we did not know was that we were actually dealing with multinational companies, corporations, and foreign governments who knighted, financed, armed, and authorized these men. We were up against people who had centuries of experience robbing and killing long before 1492, when Columbus stumbled into the Caribbean. So, what kind of weapons were we up against 2,000 years ago? Well, when Julius Caesar decided to challenge Greek power in Africa, they were fighting with spears 10 feet long, metal spears. They had metal shields and vests and riding in chariots that fired hundreds of arrows. They had double-edged swords, flamethrowers, and huge catapults or slingshots on carts that launched massive stones wrapped in cloth that was set on fire. When they came across our villages with a high enclosure, they would launch human bodies that were rotting and filled with worms over the walls. The invaders came with their armies, killed all who resisted, and raped our women. They were led by men like King David and King Saul, whose criminal acts of murder, mayhem, and stealing other people's property and territory are well documented in the Bible. What chance do a peaceful people have over these barbarians who love the smell of blood? Caucasians even developed a blood-scented perfume in Europe 2011, and today in 2014 they still eat flesh, and they eat it raw. When Kemet, now called Egypt, was made a Roman province in 30 BC, the Romans did not fight Africans to establish that province. The fight was with another Roman. And even some 300 years before that, we were visited by a psychopath from Greece named Alexander. So Europeans, with their mighty weapons, had control in Africa. Abyssinia for centuries, and all during that time, we fought as best as we could to be free from the invader, and today, we are still fighting the same fight. Things have not changed. Rearranged, yes, but not changed. So long before Christopher Columbus was born, we were being captured and taken to Europe. We didn't know what to expect, but based on what we saw when we got there, it appeared as if we would be working in the capacity as general servants and laborers. However, when some of us were taken to the arenas of Rome and Greece, we saw that the drains of their sport arenas were designed to handle a heavy flow of liquid. We later found out that that liquid was blood. We found out that killing was a sport. Such brutality, such savagery and inhumanity was unheard of in Abyssinia. The trauma of that brutality still linger with us centuries later. This kind of slaughter reveals the twisted minds of Roman citizens who packed these arenas. And death in the arena was the biggest show in town, and each bloodletting event lasted for up to 10 minutes. It was truly a vicious, horrifying, and mind-boggling experience for our people who were taken there. Thousands of lions, tigers, elephants, bears, leopards, and many other animals were taken from Africa and brought in to fight against each other. Animals would fight against man, man would fight against man, and even women would fight against women. It was truly a horrible place for civilized people. There were hidden doors with chained animals inside in the fighting area, and during the fight, a doorman would secretly open a door and release one of these animals if a fighter got within 10 feet of that door. Sometimes fighters do not realize how close they are. They are so focused on their opponent and didn't see the gate open and the animal emerging on a 10-foot chain until it was too late. By the end of day, our blood, guts, and body parts were everywhere. Even today, Caucasians still engage in various blood sports like hockey, wrestling, kickboxing, bullfighting. Even non-contact sports like baseball and tennis contains violence. They court danger even in one-person event like motor racing or skydiving, bungee jumping, mountain climbing. Why are Caucasians like that? Why? None of the other three dominant races, namely Chinese, Indians, or Abyssinians, surround themselves with death like the Caucasoid race. Death in the arena, it would go on every day for months. Commodus, a Roman emperor, was so stimulated at killing and seeing people getting killed, his matches would last for up to 4 months. Now, did we just sit back and watch Alexander or Julius Caesar take our animals and our people? No. Did we go with them willingly to fight and die a brutal death in their arenas for hundreds of years? No. Did we give Caligula, another Roman madman emperor, permission to remove the first of many obelisks out of Ethiopia and into Rome in 37 AD? No, we did not. We fought the terrorists at every opportunity and we won many battles. However, we were up against a professional group of killers with superior weapons who eventually overran us. For an example of the level of their killing mentality, think about this. Rome produced the hand grenade 1300 years ago. That is 1300 years ago in the 8th century. We are now in the 21st century. What weapons have they made since then? Based on their own words, Caucasians have enough weaponry to destroy this earth many times over. They even have weapons in space. So how could a fundamentally peaceful and glorious Abyssinian nation win a war against vicious terrorists who possess such weapons and a warlike mentality too much? The French and the British fought a war with explosives for 116 years. It's called the 100 Year War, and it ended in 1454, approximately 65 years before the first African was taken to the Caribbean.